believe we live. All right, peace, family. What's up, family? It's none other than your boy Jay Giddens, the father. As usual, remember to be positive, be optimistic, and keep positive people in your circle, as those three things are key to ensuring positivity is invited into your future. So this is going to be what we call the lecture of the origin of Moana, right? Now, I titled this lecture, The Origin of Moana, because we're going to go over the specific tribe or the specific nature of where Moana got its information from. So that's why I titled this The Origin of Moana. However, I do want to give a disclosure and disclaimer to people that this is going to be about a whole lot more than just the origin of Moana. So really, if you want to know more about just our history in general, and when I say our, I mean Aboriginals, the indigenous, those who were here for centuries and centuries, millennia. If you want to know more about that, then this is the place to be. If you're not too familiar with Oceania, and just, you know, the Polynesians and the Pacific history as it relates to the Pacific area, then this is a good lecture for you. If you just want to know in totality what happened throughout history, this is a good lecture for you. You know what I mean? So let's go ahead and jump into it. I was supposed to do this lecture a while back, so I don't want to take too long. For those who do or do not know, as a resource, especially for my lectures, I use Wikipedia, which is one of them sites that a lot of people like to run from and they don't like to use, right? Now, throughout this lecture, I'm going to be making sure to point out any kind of other resources or any other suggestions that I have for information that you can come across, because Wikipedia itself is really just like a, it's like a big cluster fumble of information. You know, Wikipedia itself is not a source, it's a citing of sources. So that's all this is, you know. And I like to give this disclosure for, you know, for any people, for anybody who's not familiar. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. Now, we're going to start with Oceania, right? Now, you pronounce this Oceania. For those who don't know, this here is your pronunciation, right? This is how you pronounce it. You'll see this speaker here. If y'all listen to it.
Oceania.
Right, y'all heard what the guy said. Let's say it again.
Oceania.
Right? Oceania, right? So let's go back. So you pronounce this Oceania. And for those who might say, well, it's on Wikipedia, how do we know that's real? Wikipedia follows something called the IPA, right? I'm just going to show y'all real quick. The IPA. Let's go to, you see how it pops up down here when you click on it? Let's go to it, right? The IPA is the International, what is it? The International Pronunciation. I forget what they stand for. Forget their acronyms. But I just want to show you this. The International Phonetic Alphabet, right? And it's just basically a way for them to organize all of these sounds and everything. So this is what they go by when you have the pronunciations. And for a lot of the information that we're going to come across, you'll have references like this. See this five here? This is ISBN. This is the International Serial Book Number, I believe it is. Let's go make sure. International Standard Book Number, right? It's a numeric commercial book identifier, right? So this is what you can use to identify books, as you see, right? So this is for anybody out there who, as we go through this, may want to piggyback on some of the sources that I cite, okay? All right, now, just to I added a tad bit of organization to this lecture. Now, I'm going to break this up into three parts. The first part is going to be geography, where we're basically going to go over the geographical region, what encompasses Oceania, and things of that nature. The second is going to be the Polynesians, where we're going to focus on just the people, you know, the indigenous people of that land, which were the Maori, right? And then, lastly, the last section is going to be the destruction of the indigenous Polynesians, where I'll show y'all how we got to where we are today. And the reason this is so important is because this is a formulaic process that takes place in the destruction of civilization. So when we go over all this stuff, you can easily apply this stuff to any other area. And I'll talk about that and reference it as we go along. All right, let's get started now. Now we will begin. All right, now I got specific parts that I'm reading and jumping around. If y'all want to follow me, pull up Oceania on Wikipedia, okay? Let's go. Oceania, right? Oceania is a geographical region that includes Australasia, Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia. Spanish in the Eastern and Western hemispheres. Now, we can go on, but we don't really care about this. They're just going to give you a bunch of numbers. Now, this is what I want y'all to focus on. I want to talk about something real quick. Melanesia, right? Now, Melanesia, right? I want to talk to you about etymology real quick, right? Now, what does it say? Melanesia is a subregion of Oceania in the southwestern Pacific Ocean. It extends from Sumba into the west of Tonga in the east and includes the Arafura Sea and a few thousand islands. So keep in mind, these are thousands of islands, right? Forming a chain that they have called the archipelago, right? But I just want to show you something now. What do you think this stands for? Melanesia, right? Let's go down real quick to etymology, right? The name Melanesia from Greek, black, and this Greek word, island, etymologically means island of black people in reference to the dark skin of the inhabitants, right? So this shows you right here, right? And for those who would say, well, where did this come from? You would simply go down to here, or you can check the other references. A lot of these are going to come from maps and notes. You can click on this and it'll take you to the source anytime that you want to double check, okay? But yeah, and you can see down here, just to confirm, they say it was due to, you know, old black race. They said there was an old black race, right? So we don't have to go into that, but I just wanted to show y'all that. And while we're at it, hold on. Give me a second. Give me a second, because I want to deviate real quick and just talk to y'all real quick about etymology, right? So one thing that you want to realize, right? This is a good website, Etym Online, right? Now, one thing that you want to realize, we could take this off because I was searching something earlier. Now, let's go to the homepage. Now, what is, for those who don't know, what is etymology, right? This is a map of the wheel ruts of modern English. Etymologies are not definitions. They're explanations of what our words meant and how they sounded 600 to 2,000 years ago, right? Now, the reason that this is so important is you want to understand that a definition, to define something, right? What does it mean when something is fine, right? When something is fine, think about sugar, like how it's finely granulated, how you can see everything. To define it would mean to clump it up, to make it hard to see, to make it unclear, right? So when you define something, you're actually taking away value from its true meaning. You get what I'm saying? So for instance, if I were to say, what is this? What is this right here, right? Someone could say, this is plastic recyclable paper wrapped around a plastic bottle with water inside, right? Or you can say, this is a water bottle, right? So if I define this as a water bottle, now I've taken away all of the elements of what this thing is, right? Or if you're looking at a building, you could say, what is this? Somebody could say, well, that's plywood arranged in the format of I-beams, structurally put together for integrity to hold everything up. Or you could say, that's a house. You get what I'm saying? That defines it. It makes it just kind of... So once you understand that concept and then understand what etymology means, you're really talking about what the word, you're talking about what is being implied by the word when it's being said. And if you understand spells in a way that works, then you understand why it's so important to know what the etymological meaning of something is, right? So let's go back to where we were before, right? For Melanesia, right? Because I just wanted to kind of poke the bears and relate it to the etymology. And y'all can look, the same way I'm going to go over everything about Moana today, which is from a town called Matanu, which is in New Zealand. There's a story for this, like ancient history. There's a bunch for Melanesia and for all of these islands, but we're just going to do the one that's most culturally relevant, right? As we go through here, I'm just looking through to make sure there's nothing else I wanted to show y'all. Because, like, these lands all have their own, like, languages and just things that that have been destroyed. You know what I mean? In addition to the many indigenous Melanesian languages, pidgins. See, who would have known that pidgin was a language? Or pidgin is a method of communication of some sort. It's a grammatically simplified means communication that develops between two or more groups. Yeah. hence pigeons, right? But anyway, let's not get too sidetracked. I'm gonna go back now, right? So I'm gonna jump down to here, right, to this last paragraph, and I'm just gonna read this, all right? The arrival of European settlers in subsequent centuries resulted in a significant alteration in the social and political landscape of Oceania. The Pacific theater saw major action during the Second World War, mainly between Allied powers, the United States, Philippines, and Australia, and Axis power, Japan. The rock art of Aboriginal Australians is the longest continuously practiced artistic tradition in the world. Most Oceanian countries are multi-party representative parliamentary democracies, with tourism being a large source of income for the Pacific nations, right? So this is basically just explaining to you that they modernized it, and a lot of the stuff you used to see, you don't see anymore, and the people who used to be in power are not there anymore, which we're going to go over in detail, if y'all stick with me, after we go over some other information, right? So let's go down to characteristics, right? I just wanted to, under characteristics is something I wanted to show y'all. Let me see, what was it? Let me just read here and see real quick. Characteristics. The definitions of Oceania may vary. The broadest definition of Oceania encompasses the many islands between mainland Asia and the Americas. The island nation of Australia is the only piece of land in the area large enough to be considered a continent. All right, so this is just gonna go over the geographical explanations of what it is. This is what I think I wanted to show y'all. See how now the continental shelf, because I didn't know what this was, and when I came across it, I just thought that we should be aware. So the islands of the Malay Archipelago, and like I told y'all earlier, Archipelago is just a group of a bunch of islands together, kind of like in the movie Avatar, how they had them, but they had them split up by air. They were sky islands, right? But Archipelago is an archipelago between mainland, yeah. See, this is telling you this specific archipelago named after Malay, but an actual archipelago, if we go here, an actual archipelago, which is also sometimes, hold on, called an island group, is a chain or cluster or collection of islands. So just keep in mind, whenever you see archipelago, again, this says Malay archipelago because they probably named this after somebody, you know, who killed all of our ancestors like the rest. But anyway, the islands of the Malay Archipelago north of Australia mainly lie on the continental shelf. So let's just see what this is real quick, just so that y'all can see. What's up, Roland 8 Records? One love to you too, brother. A continental shelf is a portion of a continent that is submerged under an area of relatively shallow water known as a shelf sea. All right. So just be aware of that, and here's a picture of it. It's just basically a portion of the continent that's underwater, which a large portion of the Pacific is. And this is why, like, Australia, they're saying a lot of it is underwater, if you look up, like, Oceania in general, okay? All right, y'all. So I appreciate everybody who's with me and sticking with me. We got a lot of information to go over, and it's a lot that I want to touch base with y'all on. Real quick, boundaries, since we're talking about geographical. What's up, Immortal? Since we're talking about geography, right? Now, look at what they say here. I think somebody about to come around the corner. Come on, come over here and say hi, since you want to come over here and interrupt Daddy.
Hi.
Watch out. Say hi.
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 And me. Jack.
Yeah. Y'all just had to, yeah. Mommy know Daddy down here doing this lecture too. And she gonna have y'all come down here. Alright. Alright, say see you later. Okay. Stormy, get down. Alright, listen, y'all are okay, say see you later. Y'all are alright, see you later. Alright, y'all interrupted my lecture, alright? Go ahead. Yeah, Goddess Daddy's doing a lecture. Okay. Go ahead back upstairs, y'all, for me. Alright, so look, let's get back to it, fam. Let's get back to it, because I want to explain to you what they talking about boundaries are, right, and give you some perspective on what boundaries are right now. Islands at the geographic extremes of Oceania Gerald and Jade, do me a favor. Go upstairs for me, please, okay? And keep it down. All right. Islands of the islands at the geographic extremes, and when they say that, they just mean like the outer rims of Oceania. We're gonna look at a map of Oceania in a second. Islands at the geographic extremes of Oceania are generally considered to be the Bonin Islands, a politically integral part of Japan, Hawaii, United States. They're basically showing you of these geographic extremes, who owns them? France owns them. You know what I mean? Chile, Australia. The U.S. owns, you know what I mean? Now, what are the Bonin Islands, for those who don't know? They're basically uninhabited islands, but let's see what they are. The Bonin Islands, also known as Ogasawara Islands, are an archipelago. And remember, archipelago is just a group of islands or a chain of islands. An archipelago of over 30 subtropical and tropical islands, some 1,000 kilometers directly south of Tokyo, Japan, and 1,000 miles, whatever. We don't need to know that. Just know that it means... they are uninhabited. Let's go into it, though, because I don't think it showed us enough right there. Hold on. Can you get off my screen? All right. Hold on. Now it says, the name Bonin Island comes from the Japanese word bunin, an archaic reading, mujin, meaning no people or uninhabited. The only inhabited islands of the group are this one right here. Right? And you can look into these. These all have... a history, a past. These all have plenty of stories, things you can learn on them, but we're not learning about them. But I just wanted to show y'all what the Bonin Islands are. Because when we do a lecture, the purpose of it should be that you can identify stuff. You know what I mean? When people talk about stuff. So this is Oceania, by the way. All right. This is New Zealand down here. This is New Zealand. This is the North Island. This is the South Island. And this is where Moana took place. Right here. And I'm going to show you that in a moment. This section right here. Alright. But anyway, let's exit out. We'll get there. Alright. Now, with boundaries, right? Now, they tell you, when they're talking about boundaries, right? I wanted to reference something real quick, right? Many of y'all may be aware that I did a lecture titled Human Settlements, right? To get to the main page that I conducted that off of, you can type in human settlement, right? Human settlement, right there. Now, the reason this is important is I'm going to tie this together into what they're doing on the island, what they're doing with that part of the land, right? Now, I explained to everybody in the lecture that I did titled Human Settlement that human settlements are nothing but cities, towns, you know, suburbs, anything you want to call them, villages, hamlets, right? And they're set up for geographical, statistical, and archaeological study. Also for medical, but that's not going to be put there. What's up, Anya Mayat? Supremeness and wholeness to you as well. One love to you, goddess. All right. Now, when I did this lecture, I explained to you how this is all set up, and I went into this. It was like an hour and a half lecture. But I talked about what do they have when they set up a human settlement, which is what? Hamlets, villages, towns, cities, states, counties, whatever you want to call them, right? So they have something called, give me one second, y'all, bear with me. They have something called enclosures and boundaries, right? Now, what's a boundary, right? A boundary, right? Particularly field boundaries among the oldest features in any rural landscape. A boundary itself is an abstract concept. A boundary can often be seen in differences. Let's go. All right. Longevity and boundaries, right? Boundaries, a real or imagined line that marks the limit of something. Many field boundaries in the central region originated with the enclosure of the previous open fields, right? Now, when they say enclosure, that goes back to, let's go back real quick, to right here next to it, enclosures, right? Because these two run hand in hand, boundary and enclosures. Enclosure, also spelled enclosure. It refers to the appropriation of waste or common inland, enclosing it, and doing so, depriving commoners of their rights and access and privilege. This is what enclosing means, right? So what I just wanted to bring this up for, if you had saw this, you want to keep in mind this ideology as it relates to boundaries, enclosures, and preventing commoners from accessing things. On human settlements, which are what? Cities, towns, villages, and such. And now, apply that to, let's go back. Oceania and this, which is what, a big settlement, right? A big human settlement. So when they say, let's go back down if y'all follow me. Let's go back down to boundaries, right? So now let's read boundaries with our third eye. Islands at the geographic extremes of Oceania are generally considered to be the Bonin Islands. And the Bonin Islands are what? Uninhabited islands, right? And you can go down further and see how the UN is involved in this as well. Because the UN pretty much governs everything. This is what shows you. But this is not going to be about that. I just wanted to show you that as well. Let me make sure there's nothing more that I'm missing here, y'all. Bear with me. All right, so let's go ahead and move on. Now we're gonna go into the second half, all right, or the second piece of the lecture, which is gonna be Polynesians, where we're gonna talk about the indigenous ones, and this is where we're gonna go ahead and tie into Moana. This is where Moana start coming in, y'all. My apologies. I just need y'all to know the backbone of what's going on, right? Just need y'all to know the backbone of what is going on. So we're gonna go here. We're gonna go to here, to Polynesia, right? Alright. Now let's just read this first paragraph here. Polynesia, right? Polynesia is a subregion of Oceania made up of more than 1,000 islands scattered over the central and southern Pacific Ocean. The indigenous people who inhabit the islands of Polynesia are called Polynesians. They have many things in common, including language, relatedness, cultural practices, and traditional beliefs. In centuries past, they had a strong shared tradition of sailing and using the stars to navigate at night. The largest country in Polynesia is New Zealand. Now, this is where Moana comes from. All right, and we're about to go ahead and see that in about T-minus 10 minutes, right? So let's go into using the stars to navigate, right? I believe this is where I want to go, right? Let's read this first paragraph real quick. I'm taking us somewhere, all right? Everything that I'm reading was because I wanted to direct us a certain way to get into things. So Polynesian navigation, or Polynesian wayfinding. Polynesian navigation was used for thousands of years to enable long voyages across thousands of kilometers of open Pacific Ocean. Polynesians made contact with nearly every island within the vast Polynesian Triangle using outrigger canoes or double-hulled canoes. The double-hulled canoes were two large hulls equal in length and lashed side by side. The space between the parallel canoes allowed for storage of food, hunting materials, and nets when embarking on long voyages. And this is from, just to check this reference real quick, this is from a book titled The Polynesians Prehistory of an Island People, all right? So you can go look at the book for those who feel uncomfortable with reading stuff online or Wikipedia. Polynesian navigators used wayfinding techniques such as the navigation by the stars and observation of birds, ocean swells, and wind patterns, and relied on a large body of knowledge from oral tradition. Right now, I want to go to here real quick because some of us are familiar with the Bermuda Triangle, right? And how that works, and that's a vast energy point. But many of us may not be familiar with the Polynesian Triangle. And by the way, for those boats, when they talked about how they used outrigger canoes with double-hulled canoes, when they talk about a hull is just that little part, like a V. You know that part that looked like a V at the bottom of the ship? That's called a hull. So when they say double hull, they're talking about these, like with two of them. And there's a reason I'm saying that too, because I'm about to show y'all something in 1 second. All right, but let's go to Polynesian Triangle real quick. All right, outside the, let me see. The Polynesian Triangle is a region of the Pacific Ocean with three island groups at the corners: Hawaii, Easter Island, and New Zealand. It is often used as a simple way to define Polynesia. There go that define again, right? See what I was saying? When you define something, you take away its value and the depth of its meaning, right? Because when you say Polynesia, you've defined Polynesia by taking away the fact that it has these three islands and what all of these three things encompass. By defining it, you make it not fine and able to see anymore. Anyway, I was just wordplay, you know what I'm saying? So you could read here more about the Polynesian Triangle. I just wanted to reference that for you. And I also wanted to show y'all something for my Dragon Ball Z fans out there. Let me show y'all something, right? Right? Because you come across stuff. So look, ancient Hawaii, right? This is ancient Hawaii. Let's deviate real quick if y'all could give me a second. Look what this says. Ancient Hawaii is the period of Hawaiian history preceding the unification in 1810 of the Kingdom of Hawaii by Kamehameha the Great. Who's that? Kamehameha, also known as Kamehameha the Great, was the conqueror and the first ruler of the Kingdom of Hawaii. The state of Hawaii gave a statue to him. Now you see what he clearly looks like, right? Now, this was during the time that slavery was supposedly taking place. Because, you know, all black people came from, you know, Africa, right? And that's where we was. But this guy, yeah, this is, now you could do some history into him. You could do some searching into him, which I did do. And I could do a whole lecture on this shit, too. But I just want to show y'all what they do and how they did, right? Because let me just show you something real quick. Quick sidebar. Hold on. Where is it at? Hold on. It's under here, right? So look at this. As ruler, Kamehameha took steps to ensure the islands remained a united realm after his death. He unified the legal system. He used the products collected in taxes to promote trade with Europe and the United States, right? Now look here. Young and Davis, these are two Europeans that was coming over there to try to overthrow him. They was coming to take the island from him. And they were coming under orders of, I think, Queen Victoria. This was during the Victorian era, I believe. We could double check it. But look, Young and Davis became advisors to Kamehameha and provided him with advanced weapons that helped in combat. Kamehameha was also a religious king and the holder of the war god Kuka Imoku. The explorer George Vancouver noted that Kamehameha worshipped his gods and wooden images in a heiau, which is basically just a temple, like a place, just to show y'all so y'all know what I mean. This is like a temple, or like a place that you go to worship deities, right? But he worshipped him there, but originally wanted to bring England's religion, Christianity. They're talking about Vancouver. They're saying Vancouver took note that Kamehameha worshipped his own gods, but Vancouver wanted to bring England's Christianity here. However, missionaries were not sent because Kamehameha told Vancouver that the gods he worshipped were his gods with mana. And for those who don't know what mana is, it's a Latin derivative, and it talks about magic. Mana is the spiritual life force or energy or healing power that permeates the universe, right? So this is what our ancestors was talking about, mana, right? And that through these gods, Kamehameha had become supreme ruler over the islands, right? Witnessing Kamehameha's devotion, Vancouver decided against sending missionaries, right? For now. But if you look at what they are today, now, y'all just seen the way Kamehameha, who was one of our ancient rulers of ancient Hawaii, you seen how he ruled and what he said about religion. Fast forward today, guess what state they are in from a religious standpoint. Let me see if we can see. You see what Hawaii is. Let's look. Hold up. Let's not go into it because we'll be all day. But what I want to recommend that you do is take a look at that. And if y'all want, I'll do another lecture on ancient Hawaii and go over all of the descendants of Kamehameha and the kingdom of Hawaii, where it came from, right? Because you can look here real quick. You can look here real quick and see all of the monarchs dating back, all of the Kamehamehas. And there was some before Kamehameha as well, but they don't know much about it, right? They don't know much about it. A lot of this information is gonna come from the victors, you know what I'm saying, after they overthrew him. Because again, they overthrew him in the 1800s, right? And I don't want to go all the way into that. I just wanted to touch on that and show y'all that, you know, you have stories all over these islands. You see the writing that they found on the walls when they went there? This is by the volcanoes. They call them petroglyphs. Right? Petroglyph is an image created by removing part of a rock surface by incising, picking, carving, right? But see the stuff that they found? This is what I... One love to you, family. What's up, Insightful Cell? So, well, look, we could be all day, but like I said, I just wanted to... This is just one story out of a million in ancient Hawaii talking about Kamehameha the Great. And I'm a huge fan of Dragon Ball Z, so like I said, it just really shows you that, again, they take everything from us. And I could bet you, oh, there's so much in that. But again, so we're going to go back, right? Now you see what the names of these islands are, right? In Moana, for those who don't know, Motunu is where they was from, which we're going to go over in a second, which is Motunui. If y'all don't remember, for those who may remember and know the movie in the beginning, he said, Moana, make way, I think that it's time you knew, the village of Motunu is all you need, right, the village of Motunu, and we're gonna go over that, and this is Motu Maha, so you can see how they all start with that, because that's the prefix that they use, alright, but oh, let me show y'all one other thing too. One other site that I want to recommend, right? It's called it's this site right here, Windows to the Universe. I mean, I'm not gonna say I recommend it because I don't know, you know, who makes this or where it comes from. But this site, windowstouniverse.org, I came across them as I was looking up some information and double checking some resources, or some sources rather. And they have a lot of information as it relates to different Pacific Island mythology. And by the way, a myth is not something that's not real, by the way, because that's one of the things that they have managed to do with these words, man, is make you feel like when you hear something, you got to think something automatically, right? So it doesn't mean that something's not true. Let me show y'all Motunu real quick. M-O... Oh no, this is the plant. That's the plant. They named a plant after it. See how they had this shit? Alright, this is Motunu. Right? Now, I hope I don't get cut off for this, but let me show y'all something real quick so you see what I meant when I said that.
Dudos, Matos, is a day to honor your ancestors and people who
I know
left.
It's kind of loud,
when I paint
y'all.
My face, I try to paint it in remembrance of one of my family members.
I can't
that
stand
has
these
died.
Commercials.
I painted his face before, but he loves to paint mine.
One love to everybody who went here, too. I appreciate y'all.
Thank
you, Pa. Oh, my goodness. Get out of my face. Don't nobody want you popping and clicking. Get out of here. Peep this. Okay, so that's just first off to show you, this is what they're talking about, Motunu. Okay, so this is where, what's up family, one love to you, alright, this is where they were talking about, alright, but let's go back, peace to y'all for coming in here. Shout out to you. I want to go back to some more things to help connect some more dots, right? So let's go back to let's go to some navigational techniques, right? Because when we was talking about the Polynesians, right, they have specific navigational techniques, right? Matter of fact, let's look up the Maori people, right? So that we can see specifically who we talking about. Right? Alright, so look, the Maori people, right? And y'all know I just told y'all You said like 7 to 9 feet, heavy set giants.
Maori.
Y'all hear it?
Maori. Maori.
All right, Maori. So the pronunciation is Maori per the international, what is it? International Phonetic Alphabet System, right? So per them, it's Maori, right? All right, so anyway, let's go. The Maori people, man, that trail of tears was lit, still digesting that. One love to you, family. Yeah, it's deep, it's deep. And listen, this make the trail of tears look like nothing, too. That's what's crazy. Watch. He said The Rock, the wrestler, has some topic about not fully sure it's about this, but sure, familiar, yeah. Yeah, all right, so let's get on to it, because I got some information I want to share with y'all. And I'm going to show y'all how they destroyed these people. Show y'all why this is what they look like on here. But that's not what they look like when you go into detail about what took place, right? And let's go into it. The Maori are the indigenous Polynesian people of mainland New Zealand. This is the pronunciation in the Maori language, right? Maori originated with with settlers from East Polynesia who arrived in New Zealand in several waves of canoe voyages between roughly 1320 and 1350. Over several centuries in isolation, these settlers developed their own distinctive culture, whose language, mythology, crafts, and performing arts evolved independently from those of other Eastern Polynesian cultures. Some early Maori moved to Chatham Islands, where their descendants became New Zealand's other indigenous Polynesian ethnic group, the Moriori, which they murdered. The Moriori, by the way. Y'all can see the reference for this, which I think is the Victorian. Okay, it's the Encyclopedia of New Zealand. But the Moriori, we'll get there, we'll go over there. The Moriori ran, let me not say ran because they weren't scared, but they kind of went to the Chatham Islands as they started their romanization process, or domestication of land, as they do. We'll get there. But anyway, so these are Maori people. Let's just go to their own distinctive culture real quick, because I just want to show you this is what some of their stuff looks like. So when you see them on the movie, because when you go back and watch Moana, you can kind of see how they got a lot of stuff from this. The Maori culture is the customs, cultural practices, and beliefs of the indigenous Maori people of New Zealand. It originated from and is still part of Eastern Polynesian culture. Maori culture formed a distinctive part of New Zealand culture. So we're not going to read all of this. Again, I'm just doing this to show y'all, you know, where you can see, you know. Yeah. Now, one thing I wanted to show y'all that I'm really proud of, that I really like, right, is something that they have called genealogical reciting, right, which we've always had amongst our people. We've always had genealogical reciting amongst our people, but it just came up here, right? And let me show y'all what I'm talking about. And we're about to get into some more about how this ties into Maui and Maori in a minute, or the Maori. Maori mythology and Maori traditions are two major categories into which the remote oral history of New Zealand's Maori may be divided. Maori myths concern fantastic tales relating to the origins of what the observable world for the pre-European Maori, often involving gods and demigods. Maori tradition concerns more folkloric legends of often involving historical or semi-historical forebears. Both categories merge in Wakapaka. Now, Wakapaka is genealogical reciting, right? Let's go into it so you can see what it is. Right, Wakapaka, or genealogy, is a fundamental principle in Maori culture. Reciting one's Wakapaka proclaims one's Maori identity, places oneself in a wider context, and links oneself to land and tribal groupings and the mana of those, right? Remember what mana is from Kamehameha, right? What the mana is. So basically, and what genealogical reciting does, essentially, right? Let's go down to it where it tells you. The reciting of genealogies was particularly well developed in Maori oral literature, where it served several functions in the recounting of tradition. Firstly, it served to provide a kind of time scale which unified all Maori mythology, tradition, and history from the distant past to the present. It linked living people to the gods and legendary heroes. This genealogical is DNA. That's what this is. This is DNA. This is all they talking about is DNA and messenger RNA. Without saying it like that. So you basically can tap into certain parts of you by re-recognizing them. And they basically were forced to remember, not forced, but it was part of their culture to remember all of the names of all the tribal leaders before them and such, right? Now, one thing I also wanted to show y'all real quick, because I wanna reference something as it relates to the Maori. Hold on. Let's go to the Maori. Now, they had something called wayfinding, right? Let's go back. Hold on. Because I want to show y'all a little bit more about how we know what they were talking about as it related to. Hold on, give me a second, y'all. Let me check in with y'all. How y'all feeling? How's everybody feeling? One love to everybody who in here. I wanted to reference to y'all too. James Cook, right? Oh, this is on the Polynesian Triangle. That's why I can't find it. My apologies, y'all, because there are certain pages that have certain things. So we're going to go on the Polynesian Triangle and then go to Hold on. Polynesian Triangle. Navigational. Hold on, y'all. Give me a second. Navigation. There's a specific page that I'm looking for, right? Give me a second while I'm looking for that, y'all. Give me a second while I'm looking for that. But there's a specific page that I wanted to go to so that I can go over with y'all and reference specific references to the movie Moana, right? But I wanted to also recommend that you look up the memoirs and the journals for explorers, right? One of the explorers or two of the explorers in particular are James Cook, right? You got James Cook. And then you have, what was his name? Abel Tasman, right? Which is where Abel Tasman. This is where the Tasmanian devil comes from. And, you know, Tasman, from him going through and just pretty much ravaging and destroying everything. You know what I'm saying? Unfortunately, he killed like a lot of people and was responsible for a lot of the domination that took place over the islands, right? So when we go into, I'm going to do this, Maori people. Let me go back to Maori people because I think it's probably under Maori people. My apologies, y'all, for anybody who's still with me with how long it took me because I was trying to get specifically to a page. And it's crazy because, right, I know for a fact that the page is here, right? Because I often, when I was doing my studying and reading through, came across this page. So I know it's here. It's just like, you gotta like, follow a certain, you know what I mean? Like you gotta follow a certain process. And there's other information that I want to get to with y'all real quick, to be honest with you, but I want to cover this first so I can move forward, bro. That's why it's really annoying me that I'm taking so long to find this. But bear with me real quick. Who we still got in here? All right. All right, so look. Here we go. This is what we about to do. We about to do Oceania, right? Here's what I'm gonna have to do. I'm gonna have to backtrack where I was because I actually had it up. I'm gonna have to backtrack real quick, y'all. Bear with me for a second. Because after I went to Polynesian Triangle, Oh, now I remember, y'all. Now I remember. All right, let's go. So I went to Polynesia, and then we went to using the stars to navigate. All right. Polynesian navigation. All right. Now look, so let me just show y'all something real quick, right? My apologies for that taking so long. So navigational techniques, right? Navigation relies heavily on constant observation and memorization, right? Navigators have to memorize where they have sailed from in order to know where they are, right? Y'all hear that? So just pay attention to that line right there. They need to memorize to know where they are. Now let's reference something. Let's reference something real quick. Let's do a slight reference real quick. And hopefully, y'all don't worry about this stupid ad they got going on here. Hold on. Listen to this real quick. Alright, now what'd he say? We keep our island in our mind, and when it's time to find home, we know the way, right? If you listen to the words that he was saying before that, we tell the stories to our elders, right? They basically telling you that these is who they're talking about, right? Now, navigational techniques, right? Let's look at what some of their navigational techniques was, right? Which one did they say, right? They said they navigate using the stars. The positions of the stars helped guide Polynesian voyages, stars, and opposed to planets hold fixed celestial position. Now listen, we could read this whole thing, but I'm going to save us the energy and time to read it. You can read it if you would like to, but it's basically explaining to you that they use something called depth perception, which is how you can tell how far something is. So let's say there's a tall mountain or island, and then there's another tall one behind it, and when this one goes up, you can't see the star anymore. That shows you that that mountain is further away than this one is because it's in the foreground, or it's in the background rather than the foreground. You get what I'm saying? That's called depth perception when you're talking about TV screens and stuff like that. So that's what this all explains to you. But let me just show you the reference of it here. And a lot of y'all may know this already, but some people may not. So I'm just showing them. At night we name every star, we know where we are, we know who we are, who we are. Alright, so, as you see, they specifically said, each star has a specific declination and can give a bearing for navigation as it rises or sets. Right, I'm just showing you how in these songs they were specifically showing you that this is who they were talking about. Even on that part that it was on, where they say the swell shape, when you read this, I'll save you the time and energy of reading this. This basically just explains to you that they can tell the distance that they are from land based on how strong the currents were, right? So when you have a continental shelf or something, some land surrounding water, the more shallow or the less shallow it gets, the more pressure it puts on the ocean. So when you have stronger waves coming from a direction, you know land is that way. That's something that this is something that they figured out just by being in tune with the land. You know what I mean? These were the people that were there. And keep in mind as we're going over this, that these are the people that were slaughtered. These were the people that were slaughtered, murdered ruthlessly. Like we're gonna go over that and just touch base on that in a second. Yeah, one thing I want to tell y'all too. Let's go back real quick to this James Cook guy, right? So look what they say. Extent of voyaging. On his first voyage of Pacific exploration, Captain James Cook had the services of Polynesian navigator Tupai. Now, Tupai, I believe, was from Hawaii. Let me make sure. Oh, no, he was from Tahiti. Wait, is Tahiti in Hawaii? Hold on. Is Tahiti in Hawaii? Hold on, y'all. My apologies. I can't let stuff go past me like that. Tahiti is the largest island on the Windward group of the Society Islands. Okay, it's the Society Islands owned by the French. Okay. Alright, so my apologies. But Tupai was a navigator. He was an organic being. He was one of us. And the way that you can find out a lot of this information is You said my daughter loved that movie. Yeah, mine's as well. I actually had never seen it until my daughters introduced me to it. But James Cook, right? He was the voyager who discovered this land. Now, this is why they have this part called, right, when you go to New Zealand, right? Let's go to New Zealand. Cause we're gonna end up we was about to end up going there anyway. When you go to New Zealand, right, they have a North Island and a South Island, right? Remember how we showed here on the map? Right, this is New Zealand and Oceania in the Pacific, right? This is the North Island, this is the South Island. This thing right here in between, they call this a strait, right? And a strait is pretty much just like an area of water that is surrounded by some sort of terrain that's normally preventing something. Straits are known for not being like traversable or whatever, right? But anyways, so they call this now the Cook Strait. They call it the Cook Strait, just like they call this the Tasman Sea, which was named after Abel Tasman. Look, here's where they bring him up. In 1642, Dutch explorer Abel Tasman became the first European to sight and record New Zealand, right? Now, he didn't stop there, though. He just recorded it. And then James Cook circled back around 150 years or so later, and he finished the job up. You know what I mean? After he got in touch with Tupai, and he used Tupai. Now, if you look at the memoirs, right, you can type in memoirs of James Cook or Abel Tasman, or type in the journal, the navigational journal of, and it'll pull up for you their journals. You can a lot of times see their original journals. Now, the original one would have been written in Dutch, of course, so it's not written in plain English, but you'll have an interpreter or you'll have somebody who reads like the audio book. Okay, but yeah, I recommend that y'all read that because it'll disclose a lot to you, because James Cook talked a lot about how when he first got to the North Island, and he was trying to get through that strait, he used Tupai to reason with the people that were there because they were kind of confrontational against him. So he kind of used Tupai to be like a middleman because they didn't like him and stuff like that, right? So anyway, so far we've seen already how this ties to Moana. Before we go further, before we go further into this, because I was about to go into the destruction of them real quick, let me just show you some more about the mythology real quick about how this has to do with Maui, right? So when we go down to it's not this part, but they do talk about the creation of the universe and everything that ties from there. But see, demigod Maui, they talking about Maui down here. They're talking about the story of how, what he had to do with the creation. But I don't know that that's specifically in the movie. So let's stick with, give me a second, y'all. Bear with me. Let's stick with what they had in the movie. All right, so look, Maui's exploits, right? They got this section called Maui's Exploits. The sun is slowed, right? In the days of old Tamanutera, right? And you can look that up. That's basically a time where the sun was alive. Is the personification of the sun, right? But in the day, or like it was alive to them. It was, you know what I mean? Anyway, in the days of old Tamanutera, the sun used to move through the sky at much too fast a pace for humanity to complete all their day's chores, leaving long cold nights that lasted for many hours while whatever slept, right? Tamanutera slept. Maui and his brothers journeyed to her sleeping pit with a large rope. Some tellings was made of his sister Hina's hair. Some telling said was made of. What they're basically telling you is that Maui went and took his sister's. Give me one second. Took a rope. Maui went with his brother. Took a rope and noose made it like a noose and pulled the sun down. Right. Maui beat the sun into agreeing to slow down and give the world more time. One love to family unity. All right. So let's make a quick reference. Let's make a quick reference, right? Let's make a quick reference. And now everybody, look, now I'm pretty sure, excuse me for the, let me turn it down. Yeah, excuse me for the loud sound, y'all, on these stupid ads. But I'm pretty sure everybody knows this song, right, whether you've seen the movie or not.
So what I believe you were...
But peep this. Let's just see. Let's see what he says, right?
Welcome, for the time welcomes and pulled up the sky. Oh, who stole you fire from down below?
Let's listen.
When the nights got cold, who stole you fire from down below? Looking at him, yo.
All right, now, you heard that one, right? When the nights got cold, who stole you fire from down below, right? Fire is brought to humanity. One night, Maui put out all the fires in his village out of a curiosity. Look, you can read this all, but they basically tell you his mother, who her name is Taranga. She is like a god. She's like the goddess of death, I believe. You can read about her. But basically, this tells you how he brought fire back, right? So this is what they were talking about when they said that. You can read it, but the purpose is for you to see where it came from. Now, let's go back one more time.
Oh, also I lasso the sun. You're welcome to stretch your days and bring you fun.
Right? Also I lasso the sun to stretch your days and bring you fun. Right? And we just read about that. So, just to show you that this comes from the Maori people. This comes from the specific tales that James Cook was hearing about from the people when he got there. And we'll get there in a second too, if y'all stick with me for a minute. There's more stories here, but that's just the main ones that they speak of. Let me see if he says something else.
Also I harness the breeze.
Yeah. So he said also I harness the breeze. I think that was them talking about something about him with the wind. But anywho, so that's enough to help you see like where this all comes from. It all comes from our people. And this is just one movie. You know what I mean? Like this is just one movie. And you see all of this came from there. So as you see other movies and wonder where their influence come from, just know that it's not crazy to believe that this is true. And again, James Cook. Who is, let's go over to New Zealand. Now we can start moving into, we're going to move into the third section. Okay, the third section is going to be called The Destruction of Humanity. My apologies, The Destruction of the Maori. Right, let's figure out how the Maori people went from being what they were to being a bunch of Christians today. Like, you know what I mean? Because this all took place everywhere on our land, all right? You just got to know that. Now, again, New Zealand, right? And this is named after the New Zealand Company, right? So there's something called the New Zealand Company. Let's go into this. Hold on for a second, y'all. Let's go here real quick. Let me show y'all. New Zealand is divided into two islands, right? You got the North Island, right? The North Island, which is called what? Te Eka Maui, right? The North Island, this is where Motunui is. The North Island, also officially named Te Eka Maui, right? And the resource for that name is what? Is the New Zealand Herald. Official island names, right? You can look that up if you like. Is one of the two, so that's one of the two main islands of New Zealand, separated from the larger but much less populous South Island by the Cook Strait. There go that Cook Strait. So this Cook Strait, right, remember, the North and South Islands of New Zealand, the strait connects the Tasman Sea on the northwest with South Pacific Ocean on the southeast. So these two are based on Abel Tasman and James Cook. That's why this is named this. So these islands were named after those guys. You just want to be aware of that because as you see what's coming, as we go on, just be aware of that. Now, the just so that you know the mythology, according to Maori mythology, the North and South Islands of New Zealand arose through actions of the demigod Maui. Now, I'll save you some time and energy. They basically were saying that he threw a giant underneath the ground, and the giant was fighting or something and broke the land, and that caused the break in the ground. And then also they were saying that his fish hook is the North Island. The North Island is called the Fish of Maui. So that's just something to know, just in case, you know, you hear that or you want to just have known where that came from. All right. And the Cook Strait again is the thing that separates it right here. This right here. It's the Cook Strait. It's the only, like, it's like one of the safe places to dock, if you can't get to anywhere else. All right, so let's go and see what happened with the destruction of the Maori, right? So New Zealand, right? Let's go down to, let me see where I wanna Let's read here, and then I'm gonna take y'all somewhere. And we gonna start going. All right. Disclosure, disclaimer, we're about to get into some pretty fucked up stuff, all right? Let's go ahead and do it. If y'all can bear with me reading for like a minute and a half, and then we're going to get into some stuff. Now, the islands of New Zealand were the last large habitable landmass to be settled by humans between about 1280 and 1350, which they find out through something called radiocarbon dating, by the way. So they're dating back bones or anything that possesses carbon, which is pretty much anything that lives biologically. So they put us back to 1280, 1350. Polynesians began to settle in the islands and then developed a distinctive Maori culture, which we went into earlier. In 1642, the Dutch explorer Abel Tasman became the first European to sight and record New Zealand. In 1840, representatives of the United Kingdom and Maori chiefs signed the Treaty of Waitangi, which in its English version declared British sovereignty over the islands. And they say English version because there was a version that was in the Maori language, and then there was a version that was in English, right? Let's keep going, and we're going to come back to this, and we're going to read the fuckery. All right, New Zealand became a colony within the British Empire. Subsequently, a series of conflicts between the colonial government and Maori tribes, go figure, resulted in the alienation and confiscation of large amounts of Maori land. New Zealand became a dominion in 1907, right? It gained full statutory independence in 1947, retaining the monarch as head of state. So this is just telling you what happened, but let's go to the Treaty of Waitangi. Because what y'all want to know, right, anytime that we have been conquered or something has happened where our land got taken from us, there was a treaty involved. There's normally a treaty. I would also recommend y'all look up the Treaty of Tordesillas, right, or Tordesillas, right, the Treaty of Tordesillas, right? Let me just show it to you real quick. Treaty of Tordesillas, right? See? I recommend that y'all look this up and just look into what it is. But this was an agreement between the empires when they agreed who's going to take over the land. It's the Portuguese and Spanish Empire, Crown of Castle, right? So you'll be able to, and this was Pope Alexander was involved in this as well. And y'all know who Pope Alexander is. And if you don't, also the Treaty of Zaragoza as well. Treaty of Zaragoza, also called the Capitulation of Zaragoza, was a peace treaty where they basically claimed they wanted peace and then destroyed them. That's just what happens. And they did the same thing here. So look, let's look into it. What's up? Who is Leo Lion? One love to you. Are your ancestors indigenous to America or Africa? My ancestors are indigenous to this planet. I don't, you know what I mean? That's like if I owned a house and you said, like, does your ancestors own the living room or the dining room? Like, this is my house. You know what I'm saying? So I would say both. I don't go by those names that you mentioned, though, because those are attributions to Roman generals, Scipio Africanus, as well as Amerigo Vespucci. Actually, Amerigo was an Italian merchant, but at the end of the day, you know who he was working for. All right, so let's keep going. Treaty of Waitangi, right? And this is in the Maori. Maori is the language as well as the people. All right, so that's why they say Maori here, because they're telling you this is the language. Right now, the Treaty of Waitangi is a document of central importance to the history, to the political constitution of the state, and the national mythos of New Zealand. And national mythos just means what we're going to tell you about what happened before we got here. They basically saying the myth for the nation, the nation's myth. That's what this is, right? And a myth is just a story or explanation of something that happened, right? Now, it has played a major role in the treatment of the Maori population in New Zealand by successive governments and the wider population, a role that has been especially prominent from the late 20th century. They basically saying this Treaty of Waitangi sets the standard for how they're going to be treating, you know, the Maori people in the future, you know, through different governments, right? And this was done under Queen Victoria. Again, this was the Victorian age, right? Because there's different ages. As an immediate result of the treaty. So let's read all the way through, because there's a lot of fuckery in here, and I just want to come across it and address it. All right. The treaty document is an agreement. Is an agreement, not a treaty, is recognized in international law, and it has no independent legal status, being legally effective only to the extent it is recognized in various statutes. It was first signed on February 6, 1840 by Captain William Hobson as consul for the British Crown and by the Maori chiefs from the North Island, right? So you got to basically get the timeline of what took place. James Cook came to this island, the northern part of what is current day New Zealand, and he was with Te Pai, and he got Te Pai to negotiate with the Maori chiefs. He said, "I only ask because mines aren't indigenous of no land that shows signs of the previous ice age." Right. Yeah. I mean, the ice age, you know, I was going to get into the ice age when I talked about the continental shelf a little bit earlier. And what they call the glacial periods, which are periods within an ice age. And then they have something called the greenhouse, climate age, which is where there's no ice. And that is something that they say they can't explain why it happened or what, you know, but I didn't want to take up this whole lecture with it, so I didn't. But look, let's move forward, because I want to get into more of the fuckery of how they killed off everybody. Because what happened here happened everywhere. That's what you just need to know. The treaty was written at a time when the New Zealand Company, right now, who was the New Zealand Company? Now, mind you, this is before this was called New Zealand. So this is how you know America's was frozen before we came over here and built it up. We were first over here. So, you know, when you say New Zealand Company, understand that this was already in creation before they took the land. Oh, no, I got you. Yeah, who is Leo? I got you, brother. All right. So the New Zealand Company, chartered in the United Kingdom, was a company that existed in the first half of the 19th century on a business model focused on the systematic colonization of New Zealand. Now, mind you, they're calling this New Zealand because that's what they call it today. But you got to remember, this is where the Maori people were. So this is that North Island that they're talking about, right? So this company existed for the purpose of focusing on the systematic colonization of New Zealand. And it's called New Zealand today, right? So this is where they got that name from. I mean, common sense points there, right? But let's move forward. The New Zealand Company acted on behalf of large numbers of settlers and would-be settlers, were establishing a colony in New Zealand, and when some Maori leaders had petitioned the British for protection against French ambitions. So what this is showing you, right, is that they were acting like they were divided, right, because the French were conquering other islands and conquering other areas in that area, and they were putting pressure on some of the other people, the Maori. So the Maori were going to them. It's kind of like blackmail. The Maori were going to New Zealand, or the people representing, you know, cooking them. They was going to them to ask them for help. It says they were petitioning them for protection against French ambitions. It was drafted with the intention of establishing a British governor of New Zealand, right? So basically, in exchange for protection, they wanted them to indicate a person of power within their within their inner workings, right? So that's where a governor came in, governor of New Zealand. Because you got to understand there was no New Zealand at this time. So when they're saying this draft, this treaty created a governor of New Zealand, this wasn't called a governor of New Zealand. It was just a person that they indicated is going to be like somebody, you know. Now, recognizing Maori ownership of their land, forests, and other possessions and giving Maori the rights of British subjects, right? So basically, they made them, this is like what's the guy's name that made the Declaration, not the Declaration of Independence, but the other one. What's it called, y'all? The one that supposedly freed us from Emancipation Proclamation. That's what this shit did. What it did was made them British subjects. It made them already British subjects, which is going to subject them to British treatment, right? It was intended by the British Crown to ensure that when Lieutenant Governor Hobson subsequently made the Declaration of British Sovereignty over New Zealand. See, they declared British sovereignty over New Zealand, May 1840. The Maori people would not feel that their rights had been ignored. So basically, they're saying to you right here that they basically wanted to pacify them and make them feel like their rights wasn't ignored. So that's why they, you know, told them, all right, you guys are considered British too. Doesn't it sound like what they did to black people? Like, it's the same thing. Once it had been written and translated, it was first signed by Northern Maori leaders at Waitangi, which is why it's called the Treaty of Waitangi. And Waitangi is just a location in the North Islands, probably not too far from Matanui is all you need, right? So yeah. Now let's just keep going. Copies were subsequently taken around New Zealand, and over the following months, many other chiefs signed. Around 530 to 500 Maori, at least 13 of them women, signed the Maori language version of the Treaty of Waitangi, despite some Maori leaders cautioning against it. Only 39 signed the English version. An immediate result of the treaty was that Queen Victoria's government gained the sole right to purchase land. In total, there are 9 signed copies of the treaty, including the sheet on at the Waitangi. Now, if you paid attention to what that just said, basically, by getting them to sign this treaty, it immediately resulted in Queen Victoria gaining sole rights to purchase the land because they wasn't trying to sell the land. Remember, they couldn't sell it to them because it was nothing that they had of value. You know what I mean? That was valuable to these people. And this is why you got to watch or listen to the audiobooks or read the memoirs of Captain James Cook or Abel Tasman, so that way you can see what they were saying with their own mouth. And James Cook couldn't stand Tapai. Y'all remember when we was reading earlier that Tapai, who came from Tahiti, that was with James Cook, taking him to all of the islands with all of our people, James Cook couldn't stand him. James Cook's assistant actually said that. He said that James Cook, like, spoke really low and down to Pi and didn't have any respect for him. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. But let's keep going because the fuckery continues. I want y'all to see what took place. Now, so this all you pretty much need to know is that took place. They basically tricked them into getting it signed. And then look, some words in the English treaty did not translate directly to the written Maori language of the time. So this is telling you how they, you know, they secretly, and this started what they call the New Zealand Wars, because they secretly tricked them, and they had certain things in there that wasn't supposed to be, or that they had no translation for, right? The New Zealand Wars, right, took place between 1845 to 1872, which is right around the same time that the Trail of Tears took place, which was around, I think, 1830 to 1842, somewhere around there. So this just shows you, again, we was fighting them everywhere at the same time. And that's around the same time they tell you that there was a French war between the French and America over here for land or whatever. Right, so let's go down here, right, and let's just read the fuckery. Alright, so now y'all about to see, you know, y'all about to see some real fuckery. Alright, you're about to see some real fuckery. You just got to deal. He said them people just wicked, right, man? Now, just follow me for a quick second. Follow me for a quick second as I read this, and you're about to see how fucked up this is. All right, let's see how fucked up this really is. Give me a second. Hold on. Now, let's, actually, what I want to do, before that, is finish reading this. Look, because I think there's some stuff I'm going to come across in here that I wanted to show y'all. Hold up. All right, so we already saw the last thing we saw, my apologies, y'all, was that Queen Victoria got them to sign this damn treaty and give away their rights. Now, let's go over it real quick. The text of the treaty includes a preamble and three articles. It is bilingual with the Maori text translated in the context of the time from the English, right? Now, this is why it's important to make sure that you know about etymology as well, because etymology will tell you about Old English, right? And Old English is the time or what they were referencing in a lot of these old documents that are pretty much about today, you know, like what today, basically, like the words that are being used today have definitions or meanings from Old English, and you need to know etymology to know that. Article 1 of the Maori text grants governance rights to the crown, while the English text cedes all rights and powers of sovereignty to the crown, right? So basically, in the first part of the treaty, they say you got to give everything to us. Article 2 of the Maori establishes the Maori will retain full chieftainship over their lands, while the English establishes continued ownership of the Maori over their lands and establishes the exclusive right of preemption of the crown. Right, so they're basically saying that in Article 2, they said, all right, we're going to still let y'all lead. We ain't going to fuck with y'all. We're going to just let y'all lead, right? Article 3 gives Maori people full rights and protections as British subjects. Now, this is where the trickery comes in, because it gives them full rights and protections as British subjects, right? Now, what do they define as British subjects? Let's go back up here. British subjects. The term British subject has several different meanings depending on the time period. It referred to almost all subjects of the British Empire, right? But they say it's synonymous with Commonwealth, citizen. So it basically means like you're a person, you're a British person, right? But if they don't have no respect for their own people, then now you are one of them. You know what I mean? So they basically were making, this is how you peel back the lid. They were making them one of them. They were like, you know, become one of us. As some words in the English treaty did not translate directly into the written Maori language of the time, the Maori text is not an exact translation of the English text, particularly in relation to the meaning of having and ceding sovereignty. These differences created disagreements in the decades following the signing, eventually contributing to the New Zealand Wars, right? So basically, these wars started because they was playing with the words and saying stuff that the Maori didn't know nothing about. Because the Maori can't know anything about dominating people and destruction and taking their stuff, because that's not something that they did. They didn't know anything about that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have to teach somebody who doesn't know how to steal. You know, you have to teach them that way of life. All right. Let me see. These differences created disagreements and contributed to the Treaty of Waitangi settlements. All right. So yeah, there's one particular thing that I wanted to show y'all, right? Bear with me. Yeah, bro, let's read this, because I just want y'all to see this. During the second half of the 19th century, Maori generally lost control of much of the land they had owned, sometimes through legitimate sale, but often due to unfair land deals, settlers occupying land that had not been sold, or through outright confiscations in the aftermath of the New Zealand Wars. So what this means is, after the wars, it was people just running around taking shit. Like, they were just running around taking shit. You know what I'm saying? That was it. In the period following the New Zealand Wars, the New Zealand government mostly ignored the treaty, and at court case judgment in 1877 declared it to be a simple nullity. Beginning in the 1950s, Maori increasingly sought to use the treaty as a platform for claiming additional rights to sovereignty and to reclaim lost land, and governments in the 1960s and 70s responded to these arguments, giving the treaty an increasingly central role in the interpretation of lands and rights between Maori people and the state. Now, this is the equivalent of us saying, I want reparations, you know what I'm saying, off of the basis that you guys said that we are whatever. You know what I'm saying? It's like you basically asking, you're demanding that your mom give you allowance because she said she would. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's like, all right, I mean, that's true, but it's also up to her to not just slap the shit out you and say, get the hell out of my face. So let's keep on going, though. In 1975, the New Zealand Parliament passed the Treaty of Waitangi Act, establishing the Waitangi Tribunal as a permanent commission of inquiry tasked with interpreting the treaty. So basically, this is their way to watch over shit. You guys see what this is. Look at this, the Waitangi Tribunal, right? The Waitangi Tribunal was commissioned by the Crown, right? So basically, their whole purpose was to just watch over the few people that were left, because what I'm trying to get to is where y'all can see that they were wiped out. You know what I'm saying? They were wiped out, bro. That's what I'm trying to get y'all to. Hold on, let me show you where they said yeah, this is where I'm about to show y'all. This is where I'm about to show you. Give me 1 second. Cause it's a lot. But look, first contact between the Maori and the Europeans was in 1642 when Dutch explorer Abel Tasman arrived and was fought off, and again in 1769 when the English navigator Captain James Cook claimed New Zealand for Britain at the Mercury Islands, right? You can look into what the Mercury Islands are. They're off the course of the coast of the North Island. All right, but there's a specific part that shows you where they pretty much. It might be under New Zealand Wars. Give me one moment, y'all. Let me try to find this real quick. It might be under the New Zealand Wars. Hold on one moment. Where are you? It actually might be right here, because see, they talking about, you know, a lot of stuff right here. They established the colony of New Zealand. New Zealand was administered as part of the colony of South Wales, becoming a separate crown, part of the crown colony. This is all explaining to you, representative government. This is all explaining to you their steps in conquering New Zealand, because it was a step thing. Like, first they established their own colony there, then they, you know, started joining forces with them, with the indigenous people there, the Maori, and then they started getting their friends to attack the Maori, and then getting the Maori to come to them for help, and then, you know what I mean, it was like a whole process. It was a whole process involving it. And everybody was fighting them. It's not like it was, you know, it was the whole world. They even, when we look into these wars, you can see that they were sending help from other forces. Hold on, y'all. What's irritating me is that it was taking me so long to get to New Zealand Wars, but I'm going to just type it in. All right, New Zealand Wars. Here we go. All right, now, I want to show you at the end one statement that they made that was like, damn, bro. It was like, damn, that just really hurt. Because they show you the Northern Wars. All of these wars, these were all wars. Look at the people. These were all wars. And this will show you more into what actually happened when they was trying to get them to sign these treaties, because everybody was not with it. Actually, majority of the people were not with it. And James Cook kind of shows you that when he talked about his experience when he went there. So So yeah, I think I'm gonna hold on. I think it's just, it might be just under here. So when we go to, oh, okay, it might have been under here, foreign relations and military. Because there was a section, well, look, let me just tell y'all, there was a section in here that I was reading where they basically explained that they wiped out the Maori people. Like, you know, like the Maori people, I'm pretty sure it's probably under Treaty of Waitangi, now that I think about it. It might be under Treaty of Waitangi. Let me look it up. But yeah, they was basically explaining that they wiped out all of the Maori people down to about 9% of them left. And then after that, a lot of them ran to this other island called the Chatham Islands, where they began practicing their own culture there. And then the French expanded over to that island and then murdered them all. And they got them all sick. Like, there was a whole section that was talking about that. and you want to remember that they're always trying to get, they was always trying to get everybody to change their religion. You know what I mean? That was, as I showed y'all with Kamehameha, with the Kamehameha the Great, our ancestor in ancient Hawaii, they was trying to get him to convert all of his people to Christian, and when he wouldn't do it, they basically came back and got down on his ass. And that's pretty much what they do everywhere, because they need to change and take away your original belief and that original strength that you may have. All right, so for everybody, this has been the Origin of Moana lecture. So now we know that Moana is actually originating from the people known as the Maori people, which are the indigenous people of what is today known as Oceania, also known as Polynesia, in a section called the Polynesian Triangle, specifically New Zealand, the North Island of New Zealand, in a town called Motunui, right? So, you know, when you watch the movie Moana, and if we had looked a little bit more into the Maori culture in terms of how they use coconuts to make everything, they weave, they have different practices, they have different dances, that you know, with the genealogical recital, they have different dances that hold information and pass down information. And there's a part in Moana where they're singing, and he says, who needs a new song? This song is all we need. If y'all don't remember, hold on, let me show y'all real quick. Look.
The dancers are practicing. They dance to an ancient song. Who needs a new song? This one's all we need.
Now, the significance in them saying that is that there were messages in the songs, you know what I mean? Which is what we just saw that they were saying about the indigenous folks. They passed, there was no oral, there was no writing. Everything was in their mind because they didn't need to write. You know what I mean? So, like I said, this was an abundance of information. I really hope that everybody gained something from this or took something from it, and has some knowledge that you may not have had before. There's a lot of different information that I can expound upon within this lecture, or just go over different areas, because this is just for the North Island of Polynesia, or the North Island of New Zealand. This is not including all the rest. There's 1,000 islands. There's like 800 islands in New Zealand alone, and then there's thousands of islands across across Polynesia, or across the region of Oceania. So each one of these islands has myths or mythology, and has information as it relates to the indigenous people that were there. You know, I could go into into Melanesia or Micronesia, which were the home of the blacks, right, or island of the blacks as they called them, where there's tons of stories and information. You know, I think the one that I want to do is Kamehameha, because I'm such a big fan of Dragon Ball Z, and to find out that, you know, obviously we have an ancestor called Kamehameha the Great, who was a a leader of the ancient kingdom in Hawaii, really kind of just, you know, kind of hits home, you know what I mean? And once you know about DNA and RNA and how it functions, and the fact that your body is constantly throughout the day trying to remember, or your blood is trying to remember and remind you of things based on what you're running into, it just gives more incentive for us to talk about this information and put it out there. All right, so like I said, sending positive vibes to everybody. I hope everybody enjoyed this this live. If you learned from it, or if you, you know, heard anything that you think is worth repeating, please repeat it to somebody. Look it up yourself and give your own, you know, lecture or talk, or, you know, cover any information that you want to cover. If you run into anything that can build or expound upon this, feel free to do so. Y'all just got to know that this, not a problem, Reflection, I appreciate you. You just got to know that this is the same thing across the world for so many different tribes. I mean, we got the Hopi tribe, you know what I mean? We got the Olmecs, the Toltecs, the Aztecs, the Incas. You know, we got different indigenous people all around the globe that this was done to. You know, our Asiatic ancestors, you know. So just out of respect for them, I think we should pay homage by discussing this information and just giving it some value, all right? Remember to be positive, optimistic, keep positive people in your circle. I'll be back with y'all soon for some more informative drops, and I hope y'all enjoyed this. One love. Make sure to comment any questions, concerns that you may have, or just to, you know, start some conversation if there's any information you want to discuss.